Hey folks, it's me. I'm not really a public speaker, but I was told of someone who is pretty concerned about the whole Mayan calendar date and whatnot, was wanting to be home from work to be with their kids for that day. And that's when it kind of clicked with me that there's some folks that may be really, really concerned about this. I kind of feel like the Lord's entrusted me with some information on this stuff. I've been putting it out in various different videos for a while now. But here I'm going to try and summarize it. We're coming down really short to the wire on it. I do think the date is significant. I don't think it's the end of the world like folks, have laid out, some of them, and other folks laugh off and say, ah, there's nothing to it. And there's pretty good reason why. So there's been so much interest in it. The ancient Mayans, which the European cultures that would have considered them savages, but at the same time, they created what is arguably the most accurate calendar ever created. They had something going on for them to be able to put that together. It's a calendar that is so accurate that it still keeps time, even though the Mayan civilization has long since declined. I need to tell you about something. Back, I think pretty much everybody that sees this probably has some idea of the story of Adam and Eve. I need to lay this out for you in a brief manner here. I'm going to try to be brief. In the garden, Adam and Eve had a choice to obey or disobey God. We know that they disobeyed God. In following God, they would have done right. And this is concerning lawlessness and what Scripture calls lawlessness. Folks that follow God, that if they had done what they were supposed to do, which was obey the Lord, they would have abstained from partaking of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. They didn't do that. So where God is only good, they partook of that tree and they gained a knowledge of good and evil both. It did cause a fall, and it caused them a spiritual death, but and a separation from God, which is what God was talking about when the scripture says that in that Adam died. What needs to be brought out about it is that even in, I come originally from New Mexico, which is the west, obviously, of the United States, and we have a lot of history about the Wild West, the lawless west, how, men lived by the law of the gun, in the old west, and it was lawless at the time. It wasn't entirely lawless in that Adam and Eve, in partaking of that tree, they did retain something and passed it on. It was an innate sense of what's right and what's wrong, and there was a sense, even in the Old West, that they would have to stand before God in judgment someday. Even folks that didn't worship God still knew that there was somehow going to be an accountability, and they still had some fear of doing evil, some a lot more than others, obviously. Evil deeds have been done, there's no question there, but there is still a sense of what's right and wrong. Man would not be appalled at the evil that is done from time to time if there wasn't a sense within him that, you know, that's wrong, you know. So even in the fall from God, there is still a kind of law in us. It's the law of conscience. And when folks fell away from God in the Old Testament, it says, it said it of them several different times, it said it of the tribe of Dan, that men did what was right in their own eyes, which distinguishes that they did recognize that there were some things to do that would be wrong. Anyway, that'll become important here in a moment. In order to understand where man's going, you have to understand what's gone before. Before the flood of Noah, there was a situation that took place in which, according to ancient writings that were written back in those days, giants ended up being born into the land, and they were extremely evil. The Book of Enoch details it, which is not a part of Scripture, but Scripture respects it. Let's put it that way. Respects the Book of Enoch. The giants did not have that sense of right and wrong, and for that reason, they were given not exactly a title, but anyway, a name of being the lawless. See, they didn't have that knowledge of God because they were born here on earth. They were not conceived in heaven. They were born on earth. And they were conceived on earth from angels that were in rebellion with God, from God, and humans. So what was born was neither human nor angel, and had no sense of right and wrong. They didn't come from God. They were a construct that was not a natural thing. And they don't have that innate sense of right and wrong. So the angels of the day that were faced with that stuff, and God, named them as the lawless ones. They were so lawless and so wicked, and the earth became so corrupt through the various different things that their fathers were doing, that they ended up, the earth had to be destroyed with a flood. And Noah and his family were preserved so that they could preserve the human race. Anyway, I'm going to lay out some things here, and go to it here in a minute. It says that he was perfect in his generations, but there was a genetic warfare against mankind at that time that was threatening to destroy man. Anyway, those angels that offended, with the possible exception of three, were locked up. They were locked up deep down in the earth, which is kind of interesting when you consider all of the different movies that Hollywood's come out with in the recent years about aliens coming in, but the aliens are subterranean. It just kind of, to me, it's just another explanation for a lie that's going to cover up what's really going down. Those angels were locked up, and One was made, it was made clear in the Book of Enoch that one would not be released, but all the others would have a time when they would be released, some sooner than others, but the great bulk of them, which, as I said, would be about 197 or so, the great bulk of them were locked up for 70 generations. I believe it's Psalm 91:10 that says 70 years are appointed unto a man. You know, so that is, with that as a lifespan of seven, and then multiplied by 70 generations, you come out with a total of 4,900 years, which is about the time that the flood took place, about 4,900 years ago, to the best that anybody's been able to calculate. Now, Satan has been judged. He is being given a certain period of time. He doesn't have much to look forward to, but the release of his brethren who came to earth and tried to create families. They didn't exactly create them, they constructed them. Through the seed of both the man and the woman. Anyway, these people, these beings, is the one thing Satan does have a reason to look forward to, the release of those 200 brethren of his. So what he did was he would have marked it on his calendar. If he didn't have a calendar, he created one. He created one from the knowledge that he had concerning time, having been with God when God was in the process of creation, at least through part of it, and understanding something about the stars and how the stars are God's timepiece. So they created a calendar based off of that. And they did so in more cultures than just the Mayan. But the Mayan is the one that's getting all the press, so to speak. All of the media attention. Anyway, it was also replicated in China. It was replicated in India. It was replicated all over the place in different cultures. But the Mayans, as I said, are famous for it. Anyway, he created a calendar, and he didn't mark it on the calendar. He just kept time on the calendar right up to that time. I believe that what he put down on that calendar, that the 21st, the world ending, no, I don't think it's the world ending. I think it's his brethren, where he can turn around and tell God, hey, you said 70 generations, time's up. In order for those beings to come out from their prisons and for them to work at getting their children reborn, and I know that sounds kind of funky, but it can be done. It can be done. If I may take the time and explain it. If not, I've got other videos that I'm getting into, things like that. But anyway, these children will see, if we see what I believe we're going to see, there's going to be a return of the giants and all kinds of monsters of that nature. Beast men. Beings that are not a part of the natural order that God created will be returning to the earth. I believe that that's what that indicates. The Book of Enoch explains it. The scripture makes veiled references to different things, like the scripture in Daniel that explains at the end of Daniel's, and I don't remember the number off the top of my head, but at the end of Daniel's interpretation of Nebuchadnezzar's dream, he makes a cryptic little statement: they shall mingle their seed with men, but they will not cleave to one another. That kind of thing makes it clear, and it's not the only scripture that says something of that nature. In Genesis, it also talks about seed of the serpent and the seed of the woman will have enmity between them. What I'm trying to tell you, though, is in order for this to take place, there is a scripture that talks about it in 2 Thessalonians that says the lawless one, which is interesting when you think about what I explained to you about the lawless. The lawless have no moral compass. They are totally amoral. They do whatever they please, and they feel no guilt about it because they don't have that innate sense of right and wrong. In that, Satan did tell that much of the truth when he lied to Eve in the garden and said that if you take of this fruit, you will be like God, knowing good and evil. What he didn't tell her was that you will also be separated from God and will die when you do it, as far as God is concerned. He didn't explain that part, but then we knew that the devil was a backstabber and a liar. Anyway, but in that, we do have a sense of right and wrong. We do have a moral compass, and that is similar to God. But God's is perfect, and ours gets skewed. We get deceived on it and mixed up. And you don't have to look at much of the newspaper to figure out that there's miscarriages of justice more and more as time goes by. Anyway, as I said, I'm not a public speaker, but in order for the Mayan calendar to take place, you go back to 2 Thessalonians, it says that the lawless one will not be revealed until he who restrains is taken out of the way. He who restrains is pretty much universally acknowledged in the churches as the Holy Spirit. Jesus referred to him by that name, referred to him also as the Comforter. And he told the disciples, don't leave Jerusalem until I send you the promise of my Father, which was another title for the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit has been holding back the evil of lawlessness, what Scripture refers to as the mystery of lawlessness. He's been holding it back. He's been restraining it. I tend to agree with Chuck Missler when he says that we have no idea just how much the Lord has been restraining, but we're going to be finding out. Anyway, for the Holy Spirit to be taken from the earth, those of us who are walking in the Spirit would have to be taken also. If we were not, we would be abandoned by the Spirit. And we have been taught by Scripture to rely on the Holy Spirit. So that would be just downright evil of the Lord to take the Spirit away from us after telling us to follow Him and that He would teach us. Jesus said He would teach us. How did He put it? He says, the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, when He comes, will teach you all things and remind you of the things that I said. So He's talking about Scripture. He's talking about the knowledge of God. The Holy Spirit teaches us the knowledge of God. And we are dependent on Him. Our life is in Him. Our likeness in Jesus Christ has been crafted by Him living in us. So we are intricately linked with the Holy Spirit. And when that Holy Spirit is removed, we will have to go with Him. or we would be separated from him. And the Holy Spirit, and Jesus said, I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you. So for those of you who are where there may be some fear concerning the events that may indeed fall on the 21st of this month, I'm telling you, now is the time when you can ask Jesus into your heart. And you can receive him, ask him for his Holy Spirit so that you are not alone. You don't walk alone. You actually are walking in the Spirit of God and can live in him. And when Jesus calls his church, you'll go with him and you won't have to worry about whatever's going on earth. There is an escape from the time of trouble that's promised to the Church of Philadelphia. Now, there are other churches, according to Revelation. There were 7 churches that Jesus addressed, and escape was promised to one, because the one was ready to meet him. The others, apparently, were not. He had issues with just about all of them. And he's talking about them being in different states and whatnot. But, as I said, you can ask Jesus into your heart. You can ask forgiveness of your sins. He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness, according to Scripture. And you can ask his Holy Spirit into your heart to teach you about Jesus and to remind you of all of the things that he said about himself and about his Father. And the Holy Spirit is the teacher that makes the Bible, the book itself, come alive to us. It's the easiest thing in the world to do. There is one other thing I want to point out to you. There is in Scripture referred to that God is the Father to the fatherless. And if I am understanding that Scripture right, and God has taught me, I believe that I've got a pretty good grasp of it, then I believe that according to what Jesus said, suffer the little children to come unto me and forbid them not. For of such is the kingdom of heaven. Whether you receive Jesus or not, I believe that when Jesus appears in the air, I believe that those children will raise their hands like a toddler that sees mom and dad walk into the daycare and wants to be picked up. And I think Jesus will not refuse them. I think that Jesus will very muchly pick them up and take them with him. So, he will protect the kids, and if you don't want to be parted from the kids, now's the time to get on the same page with the protection that they have. It's not a kidnapping, though I'm sure it'll be presented in that term, but you have to look at it from the point of view that your children are not your own. They were given to you by God in the first place, and you only have them for a time. And the fact that they grow up and eventually move out is proof all over again that we only have them for a time. And then they go out and they're no longer, there are kids sort of, but they're not kids anymore. But God is the Father to the fatherless, and he will preserve his children. So when he says, suffer the little children to come unto me, and they go unto him, holding a grudge against him won't do anybody any good. And when they go to seeing the kinds of trouble that gets released on this earth, when he who restrains is no longer holding back the flood of evil, they may even be thankful that God did take them. Anyway, this is what I believe that's going to be taking place on relating to the Mayan calendar. It's the same picture of end time events that Scripture paints, it's just the other side of the coin. It's where the what Satan's looking forward to. It'll only last for 7 years, but in that 7 years, it's going to be a bloodbath. And now is the time to get it straight with the Lord. You know in your own heart if you've done right or if you have a sense, and all of us carry it, that somewhere down the line you're going to have to stand an account for what you did. Your parents had it, your grandparents had it. Like I said, they had it in the old West when they didn't even have law enforcement out there yet. And all of the Western movies that I grew up with, as you can tell, I'm not a spring chicken, but all of the Westerns and whatnot were based off of things along that line. And yeah, they were dramatized and made into stories. But like all of the other stories, there's something to it. There's a nugget of truth down at the base of it. And people did have a fear of what would eventually be, they would have to account for, even though there was no one around to hold them to account. That's because you know in your heart of hearts, there is a God, and you didn't come around through some accident. But if you believe this, and you understand this, I'll tell you right now, I'll lead you right now in a prayer. Lord Jesus, I believe that Jesus died on the cross for my sins. I receive him now. And I thank you, Lord, that you have paid the price for my sins. And I don't have to pay that price anymore. Lord, forgive me and hold me free and clear before you. And I also, Lord God, will seek to live for you. Holy Spirit, come into my heart and form Jesus in me. And help me to live as he would live if he were here in my place. And I pray, Lord God, that I see your face very soon. And I look forward to it, and I thank you so much in Jesus' name for your grace. Amen. If you prayed that little prayer with me, then you have no reason to fear. And just because the prayer's over doesn't mean you can't pray it somewhere down the line. But his visitation to this planet to retrieve his spirit and retrieve his people is a one-time thing. So, and it's, like I said, December 21st, if Satan's fixing to say time's up to God, and God's the one that set the clock, then that visitation literally is any time now. We love you a bunch. Talk to you later. God bless. Bye-bye.